Welcome. We are This Week in Amateur Radio, North America's premier amateur radio and technology news magazine and bulletin service of the air. Here are the stories that are trending as we go to air this week. Louisiana, Alexa, new section manager. We will have all the details. The Amateur Radio Emergency Service is transitioning to a new online reporting system. The Beauvais Island 3Y0Z team presents a South African radio club with a signed banner. The postponed de-expedition to the disputed Spratly Islands is reset for March. A city in Idaho eases up on amateur radio restrictions. There is still time to register for the Dayton Hamvention Contest University. And SpaceX launched a demo satellite for its proposed global high-speed internet network. We'll have all the details. These headline stories will come to you in a moment, along with this week's special features. We'll visit with Bruce Page, KK5DO, and get an update from AMSAT and what's new with all those amateur satellites in orbit. Our technology reporter, Leo Laporte, W6TWT, says it's not your fault if you don't fully understand some of today's technology. Australia's own Arnold Benshop, VK6FLAB, asks, what do you know now that you wish you knew before becoming an amateur operator? Our own amateur radio historian, Bill Continelli, W2XOY, will be here with another edition of his Amateur Radio History Headlines. Our tower climbing and antenna safety guru, Greg Stoddard, KF9MP, will be along to talk about tower-mounted electronics. And we'll have a talk by David Knepper, W3SJ, publisher of the Collins Journal, on what to look for when purchasing and restoring old Collins gear. That's all straight ahead as edition number 991 of North America's premier amateur radio and technology news magazine and bulletin service, This Week in Amateur Radio, takes to the air right now. Reporting from Albany, New York, where they say if you don't like the weather, just wait a minute. Example, Wednesday this past week, it was sunny, blue skies, and 76 degrees. The following day, Thursday, it was in the low 30s, and we had a blizzard. If you don't like the weather, wait a minute. I'm W2XBS.
And reporting from our news bureau from high atop the eastern Alleghenies near Altoona, Pennsylvania, I'm Wayne Nelms, N3LMS.
And reporting from the Catskill Mountains in upstate New York, where maple season is in full swing, I'm Don Hulick, K2ATJ.
And from Studio One in our Central Florida News Bureau, I'm Fred Fitty, November Fox, 2 Fox.
20 minutes of solid amateur radio news begins now.
Trending as we go to air this week is section manager elections. This as ARRL members in Louisiana have elected John Mark Robertson, K5JMR, as section manager for the next two-year term of office that starts on April 1st. For more details, we go to Carla Pereira, KC1HSX, reporting from ARRL headquarters in Connecticut. Carla?
Robertson of Bossier City outpolled incumbent section manager Scott Wren, KD5DFL, 341 to 148 votes. Wren of Pineville has served as section manager since April 2016. Ballots were counted and verified at ARRL headquarters on Tuesday, February 20th. This was the only contested section manager election this winter. An ARRL Life member and radio amateur since 2008, Robertson currently serves as Louisiana Section Emergency Coordinator. He is a past president and board member of the Shreveport Amateur Radio Association and the current secretary of the Amateur Radio Club of Shreveport. He is also a director of the Louisiana Council of Amateur Radio Clubs Frequency Coordination, an active member of the Shreveport Digital Team, and a charter member of the Minden Amateur D-Star. I'm Carla Pereira, KC1HSX.
The following incumbent ARRL section managers did not face opposition and were declared elected for new terms of office beginning April 1st. John Fritz Jr., K2QY, Eastern New York. Carl Bowman, W4CHX, North Carolina. Joe Speroni, AH0A, Pacific. David Kaltenbaum, N8KBC, San Diego. Chris Stahlkamp, K1OD, South Dakota, and Joseph Pulsa, K3WRY, Virginia. Because no section manager nominations were received from Eastern Pennsylvania, By the December 8, 2017 deadline, nominations are being resolicited for an 18-month term of office beginning on October 1, 2018. Petitions of nomination are due at headquarters on June 8. The April and May editions of QST will include details. More information is on the ARRL website.
The Amateur Radio Emergency Service, or ARES, will phase out the traditional ARES report forms later this year in favor of an online system called ARES Connect, a volunteer management, communications, and reporting system. With more details on this new system, we go to Carla Pereira, KC1HSX, reporting from League headquarters in Newington.
The new system will allow information to be logged by ARES members and managed through the ARRL field organization. The advent of ARES Connect was among other highlights in the Amateur Radio Emergency Services 2017 annual report released this week. ARRL Emergency Preparedness Manager Mike Corey, KI1U, said, quote, ARES Connect is a volunteer management system that covers event signup, reporting, and roster management. It does not change how ARES operates when serving a partner entity. It is simply a system that will make managing volunteers and events easier, close quote. Beta testing of ARES Connect will begin in March. ARES made changes to its report forms last year to make it easier to process information at ARRL headquarters and to standardize the format for all forms. ARES monthly reports have been posted to the ARRL website, providing regular information on amateur radio public service communication activity, the report noted. According to the 2017 report, ARES membership stands at 31,332, up by nearly 13% from 2016. The number of emergency operations events was up by 665 from the previous year, with 1,913 reported in 2017. The top three states in terms of ARES membership in 2017 were California, Texas, and Ohio. Reported ARES events amounted to 51,673 in 2017, a 4% increase, accounting for 718,930,000 volunteer hours at a calculated value of more than $17.3 million. I'm Carla Pereira, KC1HSX.
There was a notable increase in reported activity during August through November, the ARES 2017 annual report said. During this period, there was amateur radio response activity for Hurricanes Harvey, Irma, and Maria, wildfires in the western states, and the total solar eclipse that occurred on August 21st. According to the report, 26 states gained ARES members, while 13 lost members.
You're listening to North America's premier amateur radio and technology news magazine of the air. We are This Week in Amateur Radio, distributed worldwide at twiar.net.
The 3Y Oscar Zulu Bouvet Island team got a warm welcome back to terra firma on February 17th upon arrival at Cape Town, South Africa, following their return voyage from Bouvet Island. The 3Y Oscar Zulu D expedition had to be called off due to adverse weather while the team was sailing within view of the sub-Antarctic island, which is number 2 on the Club Log DXCC Most Wanted list. The team's vessel, Betanzos, also suffered an engine failure. And it was decided that, with just one engine, Cape Town was the closest safe destination. Among the greeters in Cape Town was South African Amateur Radio League President Nico von Rensburg, ZS6QL. A 37-foot catch with a crew of South African hams on board met Betanzos in the port of Cape Town. The beleaguered 3Y Oscar Zulu team had been at sea for more than a month, logging some 9,000 marine mobile contacts en route. For some, this has been a difficult time, but now stability and dry land are on the horizon. Team co-leader Ralph Fedora, K0IR, tweeted as Cape Town came into view. Thank you once again to all of you for your support during this difficult time. The team presented a signed 3Y Oscar Zulu banner to the Cape Town Amateur Radio Center.
An international amateur radio team that postponed a December 2017 de-expedition to the disputed Spratly Islands now plans to be on the air in early March from Layang Layang Island, also known as Swallow Reef, under a Malaysian call sign 9MOW, with CW single sideband and digital operation on 160 through 6 meters. The team, headed by Hrein Milosevic, YT1AD, had to change its plans because the resort on Layang Layang Island, from which the de-expedition will operate, was closed from December until February. In addition to its call sign, the 9MOW team has a landing permit from the Malaysian government. While the Royal Malaysian Navy maintains a presence on the reef, ownership of the Spratlys has been asserted by the People's Republic of China, or PRC, Taiwan, Vietnam, and the Philippines, in addition to Malaysia. The Spratlys are number 56 on Club Log's DXCC Most Wanted list. A group of islands and associated maritime features, including reefs, banks, cays, etc., of economic and strategic importance, the Spratlys are just part of ongoing territorial disputes throughout the South China Sea, characterized by diplomatic stalemate and the employment of military pressure, including the occupation of disputed territory to advance territorial claims. The Spratlys and Scarborough Reef, another rare DXCC entity, have caught the attention of news media in recent years, owing to the PRC's increasingly vocal objection to the presence of fishing vessels, as well as that of American naval vessels, transiting the area's busy trade routes, in order to assert the right to freedom of navigation within what the U.S. considers international waters. The approximately 15-acre Liang Liang Island includes some land reclaimed from the ocean floor. The PRC has also been involved in an ambitious program of artificially expanding the landmass of South China Sea islands. In 2014, China commenced dredging activities within the Spratlys, and the following year, satellite images showed that China was building an airfield on Fiery Cross Reef while continuing reclamation at other sites in the region. The most recent de-expedition from the Spratlys took place in 2015, when the DXOP de-expedition operated in the spring of that year from Thitu Island, using a license issued by the Philippines. The DXOP operation took place just a few years after the planned DXODX de-expedition to the Spratlys was permanently canceled in 2011, without explanation, after being pushed back at least twice. A 2016 ruling from an international tribunal discounted the PRC's claims with respect to the Spratlys and Scarborough Reef. The Permanent Court of Arbitration in The Hague, Netherlands, ruled in favor of the Philippines in a dispute with the PRC over Scarborough Reef, also known as Scarborough Shoal. The tribunal said that although navigators and fishermen from China and other states have historically made use of South China Sea islands, there was no evidence that China had historically exercised exclusive control over the waters or resources. According to the tribunal, the PRC had violated the Philippines' sovereign rights and had caused severe harm to the coral reef environment by building artificial islands and an airstrip. The PRC refused to take part in the arbitration and said it would not be bound by the tribunal's ruling. The tribunal made clear that its ruling did not address issues of territorial sovereignty.
Z-68M, a one-person de-expedition by Morin Dymowski, Z-32ZM will be on the air February 22nd to March 6th on 160 through 10 meters, CW, sideband, RTTY, FT8, and JT65. Confirm your contact using the club log. Also in March, Gab Barrison, HB9TSW, who's in the Swiss Air Force, will be in Pristina, Kosovo, March 29th to April 19th as part of a NATO mission. He will be active as Z68BG in his spare time, especially evenings and Sunday. He'll be running 100 watts into a ground plane antenna, CW on 80 through 17. He will use logbooks of the world. Later this year, Z68AA and Z68RBJ, helmed by Croatian Flora Fauna Radio Club, members 9A6AA, 9A2MF, and 9A5RBJ will take place in midway from Peja, 100 watts, 80, 10-meter wire antennas, sideband, CW, and FT8. QSL Z68AA via 9A6AA and Z68RBJ via 9ARBJ. They will use logbooks of the world. The hugely popular Z-60A celebratory operation from Pristina culminated on Kosovo's 10th anniversary, February 18th. The Z-60A operating sites were left intact for a return over the weekend of the ARRL International DX Contest, March 3rd through the 5th. The initial activation of Kosovo as a DXCC entity resulted in 81,478 contacts with 26,487 individual call signs. Europe dominated the tally with two-thirds of the contacts. North American stations accounted for 22% of the stations worked. Delegates from 10 countries were also part of the initial activity.
The theme for the annual National Hurricane Conference, set for March 26th through 29th in Orlando, Florida, will be Improving Hurricane Preparedness. The conference will include an amateur radio forum. Registration is now open. Some 1,500 attendees are expected. The amateur radio session will take place on Tuesday, March 27th at 1:30. Presenters will address various aspects of amateur radio response to Hurricanes Harvey, Irma, and Maria. ARRL Emergency Preparedness Manager Mike Corey, KI1U, will discuss the ARRL's unprecedented mission to Puerto Rico to support American Red Cross in the wake of Hurricane Maria, considered to be the worst natural disaster of all time for Dominica and Puerto Rico. A National Hurricane Center representative will discuss the importance of amateur radio service reports to the hurricane forecasting process. Other presentation topics will cover the operations of several groups during the 2017 hurricane season, including WX4NHC, the National Hurricane Center Amateur Radio Station, the Hurricane WatchNet, the VOIP Hurricane Net, and the Canadian Hurricane Center, the Salvation Army Team Emergency Radio Network, Saturn, and best practices of Skywarn activations. The amateur radio session is typically open to hams free of charge.
We are This Week in Amateur Radio, your amateur radio and technology news magazine of the air. The internet is abuzz with Sony Japan declaring in January that they ended the production of its ICF SW35 shortwave receiver. They also declared in February that they end the sales of another shortwave receiver, ICF 7600GR, at their online store. Probably they will declare the end of its production soon. ICF SW35 has been on sale since 2000, ICF 7600GR since 2001. This means Sony will completely withdraw from the shortwave receiver market. Remaining Sony shortwave receivers are ICF EX5MK2 and the ICF M7080N. Both are exclusively for the reception of radio Nikkei, tunable only to 6 fixed shortwave frequencies of radio Nikkei, Japan.
Are you ready for another trip into amateur radio history? I'm Bill Continelli, W2XOY, and I'll be back in a moment with another edition of the Ancient Amateur Archives, here on This Week in Amateur Radio.
An amateur radio operator in Trinidad and Tobago must pay a $50,000 fine or face 5 years in jail for unlicensed radio transmissions in 2007, which was before he was licensed. Desi Lee Bunter, a master certified electronics technician, has testified during his trial that he was in the process of repairing the transmitters when police visited his home 11 years ago and found the equipment. He was found guilty of operating without a license from his home. At the time, his attorney had asked for leniency for his client, who was eventually granted a license by the Telecommunications Authority. His attorney noted at the time that Bonterre, an extra class license holder in the United States, is also an American Red Cross volunteer and a member of the Radio Emergency Association Citizen Team, or REACT. His QRZ page lists his U.S. call sign from a New Jersey address at N2DLB. Although Bonterra won his case in magistrate's court, the Telecommunications Authority appealed, and the judges ruled that the prosecution had proved its case beyond a reasonable doubt. According to a recent report in the Trinidad and Tobago Newsday, Bonterra must pay the fine within 90 days or face time in prison.
This is Bill Continelli, W2XOY. With amateur radio history headlines. 1945. A major battle develops over post-war frequency allocations. The ARRL, amateurs, Major Armstrong, FM broadcasting, and Brigadier General David Sarnoff, RCA and NBC television, all fight over the low end of the VHF spectrum between 44 and 108 megacycles. At one point, the FCC submits three alternatives: Number one gives us a 7-meter band from 44 to 48 megacycles. Number two, our old 5-meter band from 56 to 60 megacycles. And number three, a 6-meter band from 50 to 54 megacycles. Alternative number three wins, and our new 6-meter band is located between TV Channel 1, which ran from 44 to 50 megacycles, and TV Channel 2, which ran from 54 to 60 megacycles. FM is moved, over Armstrong's objections, from 42 to 50 to 88 through 108 megacycles. The FCC moves our 2.5-meter band to 144 through 148 megacycles over the ARRL's objections because they wanted it to be next to government and military allocations. On November 15, 1945, amateurs are allowed back on the air, but just on 10 and 2 meters only. Also in 1945, CQ magazine is first published. 1946. The military leaves our HF bands in stages. Hams gradually get their frequencies back, all except for 160 meters, which will be used for the Loran radio navigation system. The FCC creates the 10th call district using the numeral 0 and realigns the district boundaries. War surplus equipment finds its way into the ham market. This has been Amateur Radio History Headlines with Bill Continelli, W2XOY, for this week in Amateur Radio.
I'm Steve Ford, WB8IMY, and this is the propagation forecast for Friday, February 23rd. We have a rather quiet sun at the moment with no visible spots. There is a hole in the southern hemisphere of the sun's atmosphere, and it's sending a blast of solar wind our way. However, it looks like Earth will only receive a glancing blow from this stream. With the sun being so quiet, the solar flux index is only about 68, and this means mediocre to poor propagation on all but the low HF bands. If you're participating in the RIDI version of the North American QSO party this weekend, you're likely to rack up the most points on 20 meters during the day and 40 and 80 meters at night. On VHF and UHF, watch for 2-meter band openings in central Michigan, western Pennsylvania, and western New York. There have also been reports of openings from 2 meters through 70 centimeters from central California north to British Columbia.
As part of its educational outreach through the Education and Technology Program, ARRL will offer 3 sessions of the Teachers Institute on Wireless Technology this July. The week-long workshops will be held at ARRL headquarters in Newington, Connecticut, and in Dayton, Ohio. Hosted by the Dayton Amateur Radio Association, the Teachers Institute, or TI. It's an expenses-paid professional development seminar that provides teachers at all grade levels with tools and strategies to introduce basic electronics, radio science, space technology, and satellite communication, as well as weather science, introduction to microcontrollers, and basic robotics in their classroom. The Teachers Institute curriculum is designed for motivated teachers and other school staff who want to learn more about wireless technology and bring that knowledge to their students. The goal of the TI program is to equip educators with necessary foundational knowledge as through hands-on learning, generate the inspiration for teachers to continue exploring wireless technology and adapt what they learn to their classroom curricula. Interested educators can apply online. The $100 enrollment fee is refunded for applicants who have not selected. A qualified applicant must be an active teacher at an elementary, middle, high school, or community college, or in a leadership enrichment instruction role in an after-school program. Topics covered in the TI-1 Introduction to Wireless Technology include basic electronics, radio science, microcontroller programming, and basic robotics. Among other activities, participants will learn how to solder and practice by building small projects. They'll also learn basic circuit concepts and learn how to use basic test equipment. In addition, TI-1 attendees will learn about amateur radio and take part in a hidden transmitter hunt, see demonstrations of amateur radio satellite communication, and build and program their own simple robots. The TI-2 Remote Sensing and Data Gathering Workshop will concentrate on analog-to-digital conversion and data sampling. Participants will receive telemetry from amateur radio satellites and apply it to math and science topics. T1-2 participants will also construct a marine research buoy equipped with environmental sensors, build a microcontroller to sample data, configure it for automatic packet reporting, and receive and upload data from a spreadsheet for analysis. Holding an amateur radio license is not required for the Introduction to Wireless Technology workshop, but one is required for those planning to attend the Advanced Remote Sensing and Data Gathering Workshop, TI-2, where applicants for advanced workshop must have completed TI-1. The grant to attend a TI covers transportation, hotel, a modest per diem allowance to cover meals, and a resource library of relevant ARRL publications. Graduate credit is available through Fresno Pacific University, which may be applied to satisfy professional growth requirements to maintain teaching credentials. The class is self-contained, and participants are expected to be able to complete all requirements during class time. Graduate credit forms may be requested at the end of the Teachers Institute. For more information, contact Allie Riedel at ARRL headquarters.
We are This Week in Amateur Radio, your amateur radio and technology news magazine of the air.
And now with the latest technology news and commentary from Petaluma, California, This Week in Amateur Radio is proud to present Leo Laporte.
The time is now 2 a.m. in Bukava, Belgian Congo, the home of the Jungle Telegraph. We'd like to say hello to Ungat Unga Ump and Mrs. Ump and all the boys up at the transmitter.
Any way that the internet and the computing and digital technology are changing our lives, that's what we talk about right here. I have a motto. Actually, I didn't realize it, but I've had this motto since 98, but I think it actually, I owe it to Walt Mossberg. And by the way, it's a tip of the hat to Walt Mossberg, the senior technology journalist who just retired. He was at the Wall Street Journal, writing the personal tech column for more than 20 years. And he then went off, started his own company, Recode, and he's just retired. He wrote his last column last week. And I didn't realize it, but he republished his first column from 1991 when I was just starting doing technology radio. I'd been a tech reporter for many years. And in that very first column, he said, computers don't often work well, but if they don't, it's not your fault. And that's my motto. I guess great minds, or maybe I read it and forgot I'd read it and remembered it, but that's been my motto ever since 1998. If this stuff doesn't work well, the reason is we tend to blame ourselves. We're just, oh, I just don't understand it, or I don't get computers, or I'm just not good at this. And it's not. It's poorly designed hardware and software, because if it were well designed, you'd know how to use it. There's a great designer and usability expert, Donald Norman, and he wrote a wonderful book. What was it called? The Design of Everyday Things? I think so. But Don Norman is kind of a design guru for many of us. And he says if something's well designed, you should know how to use it. For instance, if you come up to a door and there's a handle for pulling it, well, you know that that door goes in. And if there's a bar for pushing, you know you push that door out, right? And if, heaven forbid, somebody should reverse that and put a handle for pulling on a door that you push, well, that's going to be extremely confusing. Is it your fault that the door doesn't work right? No. The person who put the wrong handle on the door. The cover of The Design of Everyday Things is wonderful because it's a it's a teapot. Well, a not-so-well-designed teapot because the handle's on the same side as the spout. Now, if anybody's designing a teapot, you put the handle on one side, the spout on the other side, so you can pour it out. Lift my handle and pour me out. But if you were to put the handle on the same side as a spout, it'd be pretty darn hard to pour any tea without burning yourself, right? So his point, and I think, he's actually made quite a business of informing the tech industry. He's down in Silicon Valley and on usability. His point is the way something is designed should make it apparent that this is how you use it. And if it isn't, if you don't really understand it, or if you look at it and you can't figure it out, it's not your fault. It's the designer's fault. And I hope we remember this because, come on, every day in technology, it's as if we're coming up to a door that you push, but it's got a puller on it. I can't tell you how often I'll look at a screen and go, I have no idea what I'm supposed to do here. And I'm a technologist. I use this stuff all the time. It's my business. I really don't understand. I don't understand at all how people survive in this world. Do you have any remotes for your TV? This is a test of a geek. How many remote controls do you have in front of your, on the arm of your couch or in front of your TV? We're about to go on vacation and we have a visitor staying in our, somebody staying in our house to take care of it. And we actually had to write, I've written a manual, 7 or 8 page manual, and we had to write post-it notes to explain, this remote does this. To watch the TV, you turn on this remote and you press this button, and then you turn on that remote and you press that button, and then here's the third remote that you use to control, that's how you get to Netflix. Oh, you want to watch TV, the basketball game. And I know it's confusing. But it isn't my fault, and it's not your fault, and it's not Burke, who's staying in our house's fault. It's the designers of these systems' fault. They don't. Now, there are universal remotes out there. I have yet to find one that can really solve my complicated TV setup. Logitech Harmony, right? And then there's a Harmony Hub, and I've bought them all over time, Logitech One. Burke, you're going to be able to figure this out, because we put post-it notes, and I have a printed manual. Yes, this is it. Burke has just brought me the picture. Because I think maybe you don't believe me when I say we've got the remotes and we've got post-it notes on all, just to explain. But, you know, I told Lisa, my wife, Burke says one of them was wrong. I told her that Burke doesn't need this. You can figure this out. It didn't hurt, he says. You've noticed, though, haven't you, that there are some people, I don't know if it's genetic or what, that just, they can look at it. I'm one of those people. I can sit down at any AV system and go, oh, yeah, you do this, this, and this. I can figure it out. I bet you're like that. Yeah. And then there are people who look at it and go, I don't know what to do here. The problem is the people who design software, the people who design computers, the people who design remote controls are of the first kind. They're the kind of people who could sit down, look at something, go, oh, I know how this works. And they don't understand that most other people have no idea. You ask an engineer, why did you design this website like that? I can't figure out. He said, well, that's obvious. Didn't you see the button? And you, there's a big debate in design circles about something they call the hamburger menu. Now, I look at that and I know what to do. You've seen it. Many web pages, now software is doing it. A lot of mobile software is doing it. It's three lines. They call it a hamburger because it's like a bun, a patty, and a bun. Three lines. Have you seen that? What do you think of when you see that? Do you think of a hamburger? Do you know what to do when you see that? When we designed our website, the designer said, you can't use the hamburger menu. I said, what? He said, no one understands what those three lines are. I said, it's a menu. You hit it and it's a menu. Well, you know that, but no one else knows that. And by the way, almost everywhere now, that's what you see is a hamburger menu. I guess eventually we'll learn. It's one of the things I kind of laugh when people say, oh, the iPhone is so easy to use. It is not easy to use. The iPhone is really hard to use because every application has a different user interface, right? There's Apple, when they designed the Macintosh, they actually wrote, there were 4 or 5 giant volumes. There was a whole thing on user interface guidelines. There was one way to do it, and they were very clear. This is how you do it. And software on the Mac, on the original Mac, was very easy to use because everybody did it the same way. For some reason, they neglected to do that for the iPhone. And every app has a different way to do things. In fact, in some cases, now you tell me if you're an iPhone user. In some cases, you're on a screen, you have, there is no, you know, you'd think, oh, is there an arrow in the upper left-hand corner? How do I get back? How do I go to the previous screen? And in some, in many cases, there is no way. You just sit there, and I guess what you're supposed to do is press the home button and start over. That is not good design. Anyway, my motto, apparently stolen from Walt Mossberg, his motto for many years, mine as well, it is not your fault. And that's really, if there were one kind of underlying philosophy to this show, is it's not a case of, I know how to use this, you don't, let me teach you at all. At all. I do have that gene where I can, you know, look at this stuff and figure it out most of the time. You know, I'm one of those people. That doesn't mean I'm, you know, in any way better. Really, the message is none of this stuff is well designed. Even I am baffled often by the user interface on hardware and software. And we're just going to have to stick together and figure it out together. And that's what we do on this show. We figure it out together. So I'm so glad you're here. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
We are This Week in Amateur Radio, your amateur radio and technology news magazine of the air, available online at www.twiar.net.
Members of the 3YOI de-expedition to Bouvet Island will be doing more than handing out contacts to the world's community of de-exers. According to the 3YOI Bouvet Island de-expedition, this will mark the first ever Polish-led expedition to Bouvet, and will include geographical exploration of the island, a trek to the top of the island's glacier, Olaf Toppen, at 760 meters above sea level, and photo and video documentation of the team's voyage to Bouvet and stay on the island, both for sponsors and the Norwegian Polar Institute. The de-expedition also will place what the 3YOI is describing as a time capsule on Olaf Toppen, a dependency of Norway. Bouvet is considered to be among the most remote places on the planet. Such gigantic geographical isolation, combined with severe weather conditions and a lack of communication channels in this region of the world, the 3YOI website describes Bouvet Island as one of the least visited places on Earth. Fewer people have put their feet on Bouvet than on the surface of the moon. Our expedition is really an expedition into the unknown. Bouvet is number 2 on the DXCC Most Wanted list, right behind North Korea, from which 3YOI de-expedition leader Dom Grib 3Z9DX operated briefly in December 2015. According to the team's website, over 1 million hams from all continents are waiting for a contact with Bouvet. No wonder. The last time Bouvet Island was heard on the amateur bands was 10 years ago. The de-expedition's members face a voyage of up to 3 weeks on often stormy South Atlantic waters. Grib has raised the possibility of live online video feeds from the trip, as well as social media exposure. The contingent of DXers will set sail from South Africa on a seagoing yacht adapted for extreme weather. No dates for the 3YOI de-expedition have been announced, but it will take place during the sub-Antarctic summer in the Southern Hemisphere.
Foundations of Amateur Radio. Recently, I was asked, what do you know now that you would have liked to have known when you started in amateur radio? The hobby of amateur radio is one filled with generosity, extreme forms of it. People go out of their way to help, to explain, to loan equipment, to help out, to repair stuff, and to participate. In the past, I've spoken about the negative aspects of this hobby as well. Belligerence, the warlike, aggressively hostile nature of individuals and groups in amateur radio is like nothing I've ever encountered elsewhere, and it needs to be acknowledged. In many ways, amateur radio is about extremes, generosity against belligerence, very polarizing, confusing, and challenging. That said, amateur radio is a hobby like no other. It sits in a field of exploration, of discovery, of invention, challenge, and experimentation. Amateur radio navigates between scientific and empirical learning. It's regulated to encourage research, and at the same time encourages new entrants into the field with a weekend course. The range between learner and professional embodies the amateur radio community. One of the things that caught me by surprise about amateur radio is that nothing is set in stone. You would think, with a field based around physics, that would not be the case, but given the vast range of variables at play, often suck it and see is a perfectly valid way of finding out if something works. I'd hazard a guess that the most frustrating part of asking a question as a new amateur is the answer, try it and find out. In 1920, H.L. Mencken said, there is always a well-known solution to every human problem, neat, plausible, and wrong. With that in mind, be skeptical if an amateur gives you the definitive answer on how to do something. Often the number of variables is infinite, and your situation is subtly different from theirs. In that context, the answer, try it and find out, is perfectly valid, frustrating as it is. I started in this hobby just over 7 years ago, and since then I've continued to collect what I think of as puzzle pieces, bits of information that I carry around. For example, a dit is the letter E because it's the most common letter in the English language. Voltage equals current times resistance. You need a carrier to measure the standing wave ratio. Remember to bring the head unit connecting cable when you go into the field. There are thousands of bits of information like that floating in my head. When two collide, I gain some knowledge. The most recent example of that was my explanation on how you could use the offset within a sideband signal to determine if a radio was on the correct frequency. It took a while for me to understand it enough to explain it, and when I could, I did. For example, right now, I'm working through the various types of decibel. You might have thought of a decibel as a particular unit, but actually there's more than one. The deeper you dig, the more crazy it gets. For example, the definition of a decibel in relation to sound appears to exist within an ISO standard, but you can't get that standard unless you buy it. Seriously, a physical standard that you have to buy in order to know what it is. Another example is the definition of the ampere, which involves infinite length wire and the force between them. The mind goes cross-eyed thinking about how to calibrate an ammeter. So, to answer the question, what do you know now that you would have liked to have known when you started amateur radio? It's complicated. It's challenging, and it's like nothing else. Find your own way. Talk to people. Ask questions and be prepared to be amazed and annoyed at the same time. One final comment. Amateur radio has its share of mostly harmless crocodiles, all mouth and no ears. But the overall apt description that comes to mind to describe this fascinating community is generous and welcoming. I'm Ono, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima Alpha Bravo.
The chair of the International Amateur Radio Union Region 3 Disaster Communications Committee, Jim Linton, VK3PC, of Forest Hill, Victoria, Australia, died February 22nd of thyroid cancer. For many years, Linton was a consistent and reliable source of news and information regarding amateur radio disaster response activities in AIRU Region 3 and was a regular contributor to the Southgate Amateur Radio News. A life member of the Wireless Institute of Australia, or WIA, Linton received the G.A. Taylor Medal in 2011, the WIA's highest honor for his service to the WIA Centenary Committee, contributions to amateur radio over the many years. Linton was involved in WIA's communications marketing and publications effort, and he served as the news editor for Amateur Radio Magazine. He was a past president of Amateur Radio Victoria and was its public relations officer. A veteran radio enthusiast, Linton joined the WIA as a teenager and shortwave listener. IARU Secretary David Sumner, K1ZZ, called Linton a tireless worker for the common good.
And now, with his segment on working amateur radio satellites, here is AMSAT North America's own Bruce Page, KK5DO.
We have learned that Adrian, AA5UK, will once again be operating as ZF2AE from the Cayman Islands, Grand Cayman from March 1st through the 4th, and Little Cayman from the 5th through the 10th. Watch for him on the HF bands as well as on satellite. He has two FT817 radios and an aero antenna. Adrian will be on many of the satellites. QSL Direct with an SAE or SASE, LOTW or EQSL. On February 16th, Jeff, WB8RJY, worked Jose, EB1AO, in Spain via AO91 at an elevation of only 0.8 of a degree for Jose and 0.6 of a degree for Jeff. The satellite has very good ears in order for this contact to work. Thanks to the AMSAT News Service for this week's stories. This is Bruce Page, KK5DO.
We are This Week in Amateur Radio, your amateur radio and technology news magazine of the air, available as a podcast on iTunes, Google Play, and TuneIn.com.
From the frozen tundra of Minneapolis, I'm Kent Peterson, KC0DGY, with the Rain Report Hamcast. One of the really unique features of the Dayton Hamvention is its forums. Take the Collins Radio Forum. If you restore, repair, or collect Collins radios, once the Cadillac of ham radios, the hour-long Collins radio forum at the Hamvention is the closest thing to Collins Nirvana you'll ever find. And there are only a few Collins enthusiasts, like David Knepper, W3ST, publisher of the Collins Journal. He has gone so far as to exhibit his Collins collection in what he considers his own Pennsylvania museum. Here's a short excerpt from David's 2017 Hamvention Collins radio forum talk, in which he verbalizes his love for an era of radio long since gone.
Oh, those were the days of real ham radio. You remember those days? How many people remember those days? How many of you? Where did they go? They went to the iPod and iPad and computers and all games and all that. I got two grandsons. I can't coax them. Maybe I should buy one of those new Kenwoods or new Yaesus. I don't know that they'd still be hooked. I'm 77. I've been a ham radio operator since 1955. Boy, do the years go by quickly. To me, that's real radio. This is ham radio as you know it today. It's your choice. I'll take my Collins. Last year, I called one of the radio outlets and I said, what's the guarantee on a Yaesu or Kenwood or ICOM? 1 year. I think one had, there was thinking about 3 years. One of them said, if you buy a radio today, we're going to give you an extended warranty for 10 years for $10. Boy, that's terrific. But I'm good with computers, PowerPoint, all that. when I was my former careers. My philosophy is, it's certainly nice to have something in your shack that glows in the dark. You don't need to use it and say, I'm devoted to it. I'm not going to bring some of that stuff from across the pond into my ham shack. I have one little FT-450 at the museum tucked away so you don't see it. I do have a KWM-380. But it's nice to have something for nostalgia purposes. All my radios, I can remember when I bought them. I'm talking about the Nationals and the Hallicrafters and so forth. Even my first 75A4 and KWS1. I purchased that in 1970, the KWS1, from a gentleman that was retired and wanted to get rid of the equipment. He kept his A4, but the KWS1 he sold to me. He lived in the same town where my wife was born and raised, in Brookville, Pennsylvania. So I don't know that you need that much, but it's nice to have a KWM2 sitting there. And when the younger hams come in, they'll ask you, what is that? I don't know that you'll get them hooked, but I'm just saying I'll take my Collins. I get a lot of questions about how can I find a Collins radio? Other than coming to Dayton, other than going to a local ham fest, one of the roads that you should travel on is to contact your local club. There may be Charlie that hasn't come to a club meeting in some time. A good friend of mine in Maine has some Collins gear. It's out there, but it's not being used. It's not active. You can buy something sight unseen. I'd like to see it. I'd like to take it out of the cabinet and look underneath the chassis, see if someone's been diddling with the components and so forth. I'm saying good solder connections, good components, replacing, maybe a modification. But use these as some criteria. When you consider buying a radio, and I say Collins, it should look like it just left the factory. Now that's maybe idealistic. Main tuning dial and meter dial markings are clear and crisp. Dial scutcheon and knobs are shiny and bright. All knob inlays are blemish free. You can get those, Talbert sells those, Charlie. Scribe lines perfect. All switch assemblies have that familiar clicking sound. I've had radios, even maybe one of my own, that came out of Desert Storm, got sand in them, and you turn them, they don't click. The band switch, they're mushy. Don't invest your money. I know I'm talking to the Collins group. I should have people here that are buying a Kenwood or something, or not interested in Collins at this point and would like to buy one. But if you come to our museum and your own radios, they should have that familiar clicking sound. When those radios were shipped, they weren't greased. They were no lubricant, just the maybe a bit of lubricant that came from the Central Lab or one of the switch companies. I always apply a little lithium grease to the detents. There's so much I can say about a good Collins, and that is the mechanics. Collins Radio Company had more mechanical engineers than electrical engineers. The radio is more of a mechanical device, I think, particularly the band switch and the emission switch, and also the function switch. The ID tag, invariably, I've seen them and I know who did the work. They were washed, cleaned, and the tag was all crumbly and so forth. Didn't take little common sense to put a piece of masking tape across it. You see those little hangers when your lid comes down? You know what I'm talking about. Are they there when you buy this radio? Are they missing? Why are they missing? Look at the feet. Are they original? The late Collins were plastic. The early ones were metal with a slant on that assembly, or call it the feet, I call it. The little rubber. You can get those RF connection cells, those out of Gaithersburg. You look at the feet, you can tell. There's something about this radio that's been in the overhaul. I'd rather have the original parts with it. And many times, you're not gonna find one as pretty as this. Zeus fittings or fasteners are shiny. The lid rests on those two metal tabs that are on either side. A ceramic insert in the antenna connector, not canceled. I had a gentleman from Florida that I do business with. He sent me his Rockwell Collins radio. I only have maybe one or two of them. But he sent this to me, and I turned it around, and guess what I found where that antenna connector was? An SO239. Some will put a BNC in there. There's nothing I can do. You can, if you're methodical, and take that, rivets out, or even backwards. I think that I did them years ago, of putting a little insert in there, a little ceramic insert. The keyway, the late ones, whether it's an M2 or the S-line, they put a pin right here. What's that pin for? Reinforcement. How was this corrected in later models? That pin. There's a 2A with frame relays. The cover's missing. Many times I'll not see the cover. It's gone. There's nothing wrong with frame relays. I have modified maybe 3 sets, put the plug-in relays in. How many people have ever done that changeover from frame to plug-in? Don't. That next to the emission switch, don't. I should don't too. That's an early set, and you see where the crystal board is on the bottom. That's the only thing that distinguishes the 2 from the 2A is the crystal board. Gotta have a 2A. Of the same year, everything's the same. It's that you got a crystal board on the bottom for the military or for civil defense, whatever, and the board on top is for the military or to put the auxiliary crystals in that you turn the little knob there and put those into place. Why do I have a hair dryer? Because I, not too long ago, put one of mine in the oven. My wife was away for the evening or for the afternoon, and I put that radio in, and I forgot, I did turn the temperature down, but it was really hot when I pulled it out, and I was holding my breath. And I don't recommend, that's me, from experience, putting a radio in the oven. You could find that the little IF transformers in the mixer stage, I call them, it could be the wax, whatever, you could really freeze up the little ferret rod that's in there, and then you can't turn it. I got to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, finding those transformers, finding replacements, if you've cracked and turning, you know what I'm talking, I see some heads nodding. I don't know where you get them. I guess surplus sales is out of business. But if you don't tell anyone, I have some. If I say I probably have one of the largest parts collections, you'd say, he's not bragging. He's only been doing this for 40-some years. In 1970, hair dryer, that's what I use. If it's not that dirty, don't wash it. Leave it alone. That's patina, they call that, with cars. I had radios that came out of Desert Storm with a little bit of that fine sand. I left it in there for historical purposes to say this radio had been in Desert Storm. Deoxit, it's okay. Only thing, the difference between deoxit and that electrical cleaner from CRC is they've added a little bit of oil. I've cleaned contacts, I've cleaned parts with deoxy. I'm not putting a bullet in their heart, if you will, or I'm not berating them, but I use a CRC and I don't use much of it. I have deoxit. Be careful with pots. Wash the carbon off, and they're hard to find. The paint over there is from Surplus Sales of Nebraska, about the closest paint you'll find that'll match your cabinets. I don't know that they, do they, am I wrong in this? Do they have a front panel paint for the S-Line KW2? I don't think they do. Heard someone say the other day that you can go to there and they'll have paint for the front panel. In painting front panels, use a little bit of a hard sponge and dip it into the paint, and then instead of a paintbrush, just a little technique in terms of a spot maybe on the front panel. You've mixed some paint together, you got a pretty good color match. And then use, instead of a paintbrush or daubing, I'd use a little sponge. My wife had the laundry sinks downstairs at one time, and I washed the radio. I think it was a 75A series. You couldn't believe the nicotine. This is an advertisement against smoking. You couldn't believe what came off that radio. It's a lot of work. The next slide is to keep your fingers out of it. There's a lot of steps, and I've pulled them out maybe 2-3 times until I got them right, until the knob, the dial turns right. You can modify them. Capacitors. This little trimmer up here is the one that adjusts the balance between upper and lower sideband. When that thing is defective, to say it needs cleaned, whatever, or it's stuck, you got to take that whole thing apart just for that little trimmer. The other one on the other side is for the frequency excursion to put it back on frequency.
This has been an excerpt from the 2017 Dayton Hamvention Collins Radio Forum, voiced by David Knepper, W3ST, who spoke of his devotion to Collins Radio, once the pride of mid-America. David maintains an exhibit of his Collins gear in Sidman, Pennsylvania. He is the publisher of the Collins Journal, available only online today. David's email is collinsradio@comcast.net. That's collinsradio@comcast.net. I'm Kent Peterson, KC0DGY, bidding all you radio collectors very 73.
You're listening to North America's premier amateur radio and technology news magazine of the air. We are This Week in Amateur Radio, distributed worldwide at TWIAR.net.
Payette, Idaho's amateur radio operators need no longer fear for their hobby's local future. The city of Payette, Idaho's latest ordinance regulating the placement and height of personal wireless facilities, spires, poles, antennas, steeples, towers, and other such structures is essentially a slightly reduced version of an ordinance passed a year ago. The new law largely does away with the previous version's provisions, which had raised a red flag among ham radio enthusiasts. Gone with the passage of the new measure, Ordinance 1438 is a restriction against placing towers supporting amateur radio antennas in the front, side, or street side yard of a residential lot. Gone also is last year's new 30-foot tower height limit for an amateur radio antenna, where no limit had previously existed. Ordinance 1438 increases the limit to 70 feet and does away with the requirement for a conditional use permit for any antenna taller than 35 feet. The City Council passed Ordinance 1438 at its meeting on February 5th, following a public hearing that same night, which included supportive testimony from two local amateur radio operators, Julie Bunker and Neil Nielsen. Bunker, who serves as Payette County Emergency Coordinator for Amateur Radio Emergency Services, told the council that the easiest fix for the problems with last year's ordinance would have been to just remove all references to amateur radio. Although radio operators view that as a preferable course, Bunker conceded that the newest ordinance does provide reasonable accommodation for amateur radio. She called it a good compromise. Ordinance 1423, which introduced restrictions on amateur radio facilities, was passed by the City Council in February of 2017. During earlier public hearings on the proposal held by the City of Payette, Planning and Zoning Commission and the City Council, no local amateur radio operators testified because they apparently didn't realize that the measure, which broadly addressed wireless facilities, also happened to contain language specifically directed at amateur radio. A month after the ordinance was passed, a number of amateur radio operators appeared before City Council to air their concerns about the new city law. The council in turn assured the operators that city government would revisit the matter, but the procedure for that entailed another review and recommendation before the City Council could act.
Student registration remains open for the 2018 Contest University, Thursday, May 17th at the Crown Plaza Hotel in downtown Dayton, the day before the Hamvention in Xenia. The all-day session for contesting veterans and newcomers will touch on all aspects of amateur radio contesting. CTU scholarships are available through a grant from the Northern California DX Foundation for students age 25 and younger. Contact CTU for more information. Registrants who have given or will give a Hamvention presentation, or those who have given a Hamfest or group presentation on amateur radio since May 17th, may qualify for a $10 registration fee discount. Choose the Registration with Club Talk discount box. CTU sponsors include ICOM America, DX Engineering, the Northern California DX Foundation, the YASME Foundation, the Radio Club of America, and CQ Magazine. The May 2018 session will mark the 12th consecutive year for CTU Dayton. For more information, go to the CTU website.
This week we welcome back Greg Stoddard, KF9MP, our resident expert on antenna and tower installation. This week Greg talks to us about tower-mounted electronics.
One question I got via email concerning tower-mounted electronics and where to start. Here's what I did on my latest 900 MHz install. Concerning feed lines, I use the 900 MHz band for a one-way link between my recording studio at home and the local repeater for airing This Week in Amateur Radio. Feed line loss at 900 MHz is horrible unless you intend to spend lots of money on pressurized semi-rigid feed line. One solution to this problem is to mount the electronics on the tower and limit the feed line to, say, 2 or 3 feet. It's easy to run 115 volts AC up the tower. Make sure the wires you choose to install are the outdoor type with three wires. Also check with the tower owner to be sure it's legal to do so. Probably any lighted or registered tower would require you to run the power wires through conduit. Actually, running conduit on a tower is rather easily since it's generally in a straight line. Okay, so you've installed the power to the place where you intend to mount the electronics and antenna. Your next job is to find a suitable cabinet. If your space requirements are small, like the size of a small HF rig, you're in luck. For those needing to obtain and tower mount a larger cabinet, here's how I handle a couple of those projects. First, We gathered all the equipment to be put in the cabinet on the tower and arranged it to take up minimal space but allow sufficient cooling airflow. Then we located a cabinet that came close to the size and height and width. I took it to a local welding shop and had them cut all the way around the outside, splice in 5 inches of steel to make it deeper. After the bill was paid, I sealed it with silicone and paint and tested it with a water hose for a watertight seal. I did install 2 drain holes in the bottom just in case. For smaller projects, marine battery cases work well for housing tower-mounted electronics. You'll need a mounting bracket of some sort and some holes in the box, but they're cheap and durable. Hamfests are good places to look to pick up plastic boxes for outside mounting. I found several with molded-in nuts for mounting, clear plastic doors with key locks for real cheap, my favorite 2 words. Some common mounting devices for electronics on the tower are hose clamps, antenna U-bolts, most brass screws and nuts, as well as custom-made brackets from scrap steel. If you live in an area with a large industrial area, try to get to know someone that works as an industrial electrician who can help you scrounge old steel electrical cabinets, scrap steel, wire, and other hardware. Most of my best outdoor installations were made from old control cabinets destined for the scrap steel bin or the landfill. And while you're building your tower-mounted box, be sure to consider how to safely put it on the tower and gain access to it. Remember, money spent on books and videos relating to tower safety is always money well spent. Invest in your safety soon. Don't be a statistic. This is Greg Stoddard, KF9MP, reporting for This Week in Amateur Radio.
And finally this week, Elon Musk's SpaceX wants to deliver high-speed internet to the world using thousands of small satellites. And this week, that plan is moving closer to reality. The company launched a rocket from Vandenberg Air Force Base in California at 6:17 a.m. local time on Wednesday. On board were 2 experimental satellites that will test out the technology SpaceX plans to use for its internet service, according to public filings. SpaceX has the blessing of the FCC to send up the test satellites, and last week, FCC Chairman Ajit Pai gave SpaceX's internet ambitions a nudge by urging the FCC to approve SpaceX's broader internet proposal. SpaceX's plan is to deliver broadband services directly to people anywhere in the United States or around the world at speeds similar to some of the quickest ground-based internet connections. Billions of people around the globe still lack internet access, so companies have been racing to find a better way to beam internet down from the sky. They include OneWeb, a startup that's attracted backing from the likes of Richard Branson's Virgin Group, Coca-Cola, and Qualcomm. And that startup already has approval from the FCC to send internet satellites into orbit. FCC Chairman Pai, who was appointed by President Trump, said last week that if SpaceX gets approval for its satellite project, it'll be the first for an American-based company in the internet and space race. Some of SpaceX's internal financial documents obtained by the Wall Street Journal last year show the company has high expectations for this satellite network. The journal reported SpaceX projected the satellite internet business would have over 40 million subscribers and bring in more than $30 billion in revenue by 2025. SpaceX's test satellites were not the only thing aboard the rocket. The primary mission is to deliver a satellite called PAZ, P-A-Z, for the Spanish government. According to European firm Airbus, which was the primary contractor for PAZ, the satellite will serve many different applications, including defense and security. It'll stay in orbit for about 5.5 years, making full loops around Earth 15 times per day. It'll be able to capture images of our home planet, day or night, and no matter what the weather looks like, using radar technology. Earlier this month, SpaceX captured the public's attention with the launch of its massive new rocket, called Falcon Heavy. It became the most powerful operational rocket in the world. There are plans to fly a communications satellite and a payload for the U.S. Air Force on board a Falcon Heavy later this year.
Many of the news and information items heard on This Week in Amateur Radio have been provided by the American Radio Relay League, the ARRL letter, AMSAT, the Radio Amateurs of Canada, amateur radio newsletters from around the world, sources on the internet, and the packet bulletin board systems of the United States and Canada.
This Week in Amateur Radio is heard on nets and repeaters all around the world and all across North America on great repeater systems like our flagship repeater, K2CT, operated by the Albany Amateur Radio Association on 145.19 MHz in New Scotland, New York.
This Week in Amateur Radio is produced by Community Video Associates Incorporated, a New York State nonprofit corporation. If you would like to become an affiliate, submit news items, send us comments about the weekly amateur radio bulletin service, or just to support us, please get in contact with us via our Facebook page. Just log into Facebook and search for the group This Week in Amateur Radio. You can also find us on Twitter at twitter.com/TWIAR. For program audio, archives, and the latest amateur radio news, visit our website at twiar.net. This Week in Amateur Radio version 2.0 is produced and distributed under a Creative Commons non-commercial share-alike license. Now, for the staff of This Week in Amateur Radio, this is Jessica Bowen, KC2VWX, saying 73 until next week.